Hello everybody, Crit Crab here with another story, this one about a player who could not stop cheating. And when he was caught, he actually tried blaming other people for him cheating. Roll post. So, a bit of context. I've been playing D&D for ages, almost a decade now. My very first game was with my father and godfather. My first two non-family groups were horrific, a story for another time, but from there out I had a fantastic time. Great people, great groups. One of these groups I joined over 4 years ago now. We played some fantastic games. Myself, my best friend Skippy, our forever DM, not so much anymore, Varen, Pex, a newcomer who joined just as this erupted, but a fantastic person, and then, the focus of this story. We'll call him Charlie. There are two other members of the group, but they don't really take part in the story except as bystanders and Varen's boyfriend. We run two games, alternating on weekends. Names have been changed, etc. Buckle up, this is gonna be a long post. So Skippy is running a game, Starfinder, D&D in space for those who don't know. I'm running a biohacker, which is a medic slash alchemist ratfolk named Doc. Varen is playing a slime girl mechanic, tech person with a drone. Pex is playing another mechanic, this time a fish person in a 1980s diver suit. And Charlie is playing a Vesk, a big angry lizard Solarian, which is a solar-powered paladin monk with a lightsaber. Now, for those who don't know, it's generally accepted that Solarians are one of the best classes, to such a degree that it's kind of insane. This is our second Starfinder game, and I spent much of the first one lamenting their unreasonable power. No one was playing one at the time, this is important later. A Vesk Solarian, more so than most. A few important in-game rules. In Starfinder, you can add your level to your weapon, but only if you're specialized in it. Classes are specialized in any weapon they get proficiency in, but you need to take an extra feat to be specialized in other weapons. You can only carry a given amount of weapons in combat, two big guns and a sidearm generally. There are some ways around this, weapon mounted on the wrist or on power armor, and if it's high-tech enough for you to be able to do things like taking digital copies of people's minds. Okay, all that out of the way. We are in the middle of a fight with a horde of what are basically Zerg. Doc carries a flamethrower and needle gun generally, while our tank Charlie's Solarian is standing behind Pex's character and is complaining that we are in the way of him using his heavy weapon, which is a minigun. Yes, he's carrying a minigun around. I politely point out the fact that my flamethrower is a huge cone. It's going to be more useful against the Horde, at which point Varen's slime girl hurls a grenade into the Horde. Turns out that when these things die, they death burst, and each burst triggers the next one, and they stack. You're not supposed to be close to them. So the DM points out that doing this will total party kill us with something along the lines of 500d6 of acid damage. We don't throw grenades. Now, it's at this point we find out Charlie's Solarian has power armor. Something strikes me as odd, but I continue on with the game. Session ends, and I ask Charlie how he's got power armor, and he says that he purchased it. I just roll with it and go, "Oh, cool, so you got proficiency in it." There's a pause, and he goes, "Yeah, I couldn't wear it otherwise." I just put it down as having asked a stupid question, much like most D&D games. Much like most D&D games, to have proficiency in heavy armor, you need proficiency in the thing before it. In Starfinder, it goes light, to heavy, to power. He then later on uses a grenade launcher, another two-handed weapon. I just put it down to him using his weapon mount or whatever it was. He's also adding his level to his damage with these weapons. Solarian doesn't give proficiency in rifle-type weapons, let alone heavy weapons. This is all in one session. I bring it up casually, so hold on. You drop the minigun, draw your grenade launcher, and then fire it. Do you swap it with your minigun on your attachment? The response goes as follows. No, I use my other hand to fire it. My armor holds my other gun. I shrug and play on. A few rounds later, the wave hits us, and he gets attacked. The DM asks for his AC, and I can't remember the exact number, but it's an insane number. It was something like 36 or so. Most of the group goes, "What?" or various versions of that. For you 5e players, it would be like asking someone their AC and them responding with, 25 or so. Now, we don't play very fast, at least compared to some other games. I ask the whole question the table is after, how? And he responds with, power armor, bit of dex, shield, natural armor. I think there's something else in there, I'll check later. Now in Starfinder, shields take up your hand. You cannot use it for anything else. Having forgotten the grenade launcher event, I go, impressive, I think mine is, and rattle off my AC. We continue and win the fight. I'm going to deviate a bit here because it's important to note that our group had been playing for going on 4 years at this point. And over the end of the last game and this game, cracks had started to develop. Charlie had started to complain that I was always playing broken characters, and I needed to be all-powerful. To put this in comparison, in our first Starfinder game where Varen was GMing, I was playing a soldier, a fighter, who sniped. I did low average damage. The only real power I had was that I could hit things from so far away I didn't need to get on the combat map. Skippy was playing a mechanic with an AI in his brain, and functioned as a target maker for my sniper. And Charlie started out as a mystic, a cleric slash wizard, basically a spellcaster in space. And he got boosts from the GM because they complained. Then swapped to Solarian after I bitched about Solarians being broken as all get out. They even pressured Varen into letting them play with an extra character who was level 18 or 20, using this character to pressure others. It got to the point where part of the game had to be retconned. Now, Skippy and I are pretty high on the autistic spectrum, so we are very quick to look for compromise and avoid conflict at all costs, as we panic and stress out. And Varen has extreme anxiety and depression to the point of being on medication. So this sort of stress has put a lot of pressure on our group. He was also continuously telling me that the only reason I hated Solarians was because he was playing one and I felt threatened because he was better than me. I mean, I'm playing a medic whose primary damage output is a flamethrower and spends most turns stopping people from dying. An arthritic spider is more of a threat than my character. Now, in the current game, Charlie was going on and on about how powerful he was and how big his explosives were. Skippy let players run a little wild with the sci-fi tech because, well, it's fun. And we tended to play with the rule of cool. He was pretty good at pricing it out. However, he made a bit of a mistake here, letting Charlie play with the explosives, resulting in him having a lump of C4 that could do enough damage to level a small city. He was constantly harping on about this and how it could kill everyone. At the same time, he was constantly berating me for going over the calculations for my character in the channel dedicated to the game. I often shared my calculations with the rest of the group, so it didn't come as a surprise when I do something weird and to make sure I don't have my math wrong. Very early on in the game, my character caught Charlie in the cone of his flamethrower when Charlie's character charged into a fight. I apologized out of character, and in character, Doc's next action was to heal the damage he dealt. Charlie never let that go and was harping on about it constantly. He also insisted on calling Varen's character Miss TPK due to the accident with the grenade and not knowing the enemy exploded on death, despite continually saying he could TPK the entire party if he wanted, and implying that he would if we didn't do what he wanted. We really weren't sure what was going on, but Charlie had done a 180 from being a nice player to a total asshat. There was even shit going on in the other game Varen was running for us. But again, that's another story. I will share if people ask. During all this, Doc purchases a device that lets him create a clone, although it has no soul or mind. Before each mission, Doc copies his mind onto the ship's computer and leaves instructions that if he dies, it is to upload his mind into his clone, which drags his soul into the clone. The DM rules that this is okay, but it costs 10k money per level I have. A huge amount of money till late levels. I mentioned that Doc can survive Charlie's character's insane bombs after he mentions for the umpteenth time that he can kill the entire party. And he throws a small shit-fit in game chat about how it's unfair that I can survive anything he does and always. Now, I have a habit of recording my roll20 rolls. I swear that site has a vendetta against me. My average d20 roll is 6.7 over the course of 10,000 rolls. So after the session, I'm going back through the rolls and my brain catches something. He's adding his level to damage, but has power armor? Solarians don't have the proficiencies for either of those. Starfinder has the same feat progression as Pathfinder and 3.5. You get a feat at every odd level. Now, we were level 6, so I sat down and worked out the total list of feats he would need. He would need 3 feats alone to be able to add his level to damage with his heavy weapons. He would need a further 2 feats to use his power armor. I bring this up to our DM, and he is as perplexed as I am. I ask for permission to see Charlie's sheet, and I'm given it, on the condition that I screen share with the DM while I'm doing it, so that the DM can make sure I do no editing to the sheet. Now, to reiterate, we have been playing as a group for over 4 years, through several campaigns. We are all fantastic friends, even if we live all over the world, and we trust each other, so we never question what people are doing with characters. But what I saw shocked me. Now, I've never played with someone who's cheated before, thank God. At least, until then. When the DM and I look at Charlie's sheet, he had feats he does not qualify for, unnamed weapons that are far more powerful than they are level appropriate, weapons that just had names but nothing else, bonuses that had no source or explanation, the list went on and on. He had made use of abilities that state they would require specific approval from the GM before they're used, and doubled up on abilities that replaced each other. The DM was shocked, to say the least. He instantly locked everyone's sheets and went through them on his own, ability by ability, and posted up on the group chat that he has locked down everyone's sheets due to in-story events, and him needing to look things over. Charlie instantly asked what needed looking over, and that he had some time now to go over his own sheet. We played Varen's game the week after, and that went terribly, with Charlie causing more problems. Over the week, Skippy, Varen, and I talked. We tried to work out how to approach things, how we could feasibly explain things away as an accident and help him. We concluded that if it was just one or two errors, then it would be easy to put down as a misunderstanding and get on with the game. But with such a huge amount of clear and definable errors, it had to be either malicious or something else. Skippy and Varen both approached Charlie and asked him in subtle ways about things, and he just told them he was doing nothing wrong. And somehow, I was the person doing wrong. Well, Skippy's game rolled around and we sat down. We went through everyone's sheets, a few minor errors, and finally it came time to go over Charlie's sheet. It didn't take long for him to realize that something was amiss, when both the DM and I listed off a litany of missing things. He got very defensive and started to complain that we had set him up, and that it was all honest mistakes. Skippy attempted to calm him down and tell him that he needed to listen. Meanwhile, Charlie started to insist that it was somehow my fault he had f***ed it up. It took both myself and Skippy yelling at him to get him to calm down and listen, and even then he would retort to everything we said by either trying to blame Varen, Skippy, or myself. Eventually, we got tired and laid out all the problems he had been causing and that he needed to get his house in order. All throughout this, he was insisting that it was somehow my fault and that he was not in the wrong. When we finally told him that the problem was not only with his sheet, but his attitude and how he was roleplaying, he quit the Discord server and deleted his Roll20 account and refused to talk to any of us for a few months. Varen and Charlie still sometimes talk to him. According to them, he still believes it's all my fault and I'm some kind of evil sociopath. Our group still plays and is still my favorite D&D group of all time. So that's my "we had a cheater in our group" game. And hey, Charlie, if you're reading this, I forgive you, man. And for whatever you think I did, I'm sorry. Maybe we can sit down sometime and talk it through and I can explain where mistakes were made. And if you don't want to, I get that. Sometimes it's hard to realize where things went wrong, and to everyone else, if you want the story of what was going on in Varen's game at the same time as all this went down, let me know. End post. I don't like any cheaters, but I can confidently say that cheating in a tabletop role-playing game is about as low as you can go. There's almost never a good reason for a player to cheat in a role-playing game. How does one even have fun when boosting their character? It takes away any sense of thrill or adventurousness if you know that you can just Kirito your way through any obstacle without any risk for no good reason. But when you get caught, it's gotta be tempting to go into damage control mode and try and cover your tracks by saying that they were honest mistakes or to shove responsibility onto others. But trust me, it only gets worse from there. If you've cheated and you've been caught, you are usually presented with two options. One, pull out every excuse and blame everyone else you can, damaging your friendships and making you look like an absolute tool. Or two, take the L, ask for forgiveness, and just move on. Your friends may treat you suspiciously for a while or use it as a chance to dunk on you from time to time. Heck, depending on how bad it was, they might just drop you then and there. But it's far better than the alternative. Now, I'm a dungeon master, and everyone who watches this channel knows dungeon masters never cheat or bend the rules even a little bit. But even though I have never been in the position where I had to fudge a roll a couple of numbers, I think I can pretty definitively say that the second option is just better. Anyways, if you enjoyed this video, please do leave a like and subscribe to the channel for more stories just like this one. Till next time.